Introducing to you in the blue corner, wearing black shorts, he's still at 11 stone, 6 pounds, 3 ounces. This is his 87th professional contest, from Bolton, Chris Twinny Chaos Jenkinson! And his opponent in the red corner, wearing the black shorts. He comes from Halifax, across the Pennines, we have a local derby. Will you please welcome Jabran Don Pillar! Your timekeeper, Gary Brennan from Burnley, and your referee, Darren Sargentson from Manchester. 4 3-minute rounds.
Here we go, fight number 6. We've got Jabran Bilal versus Chris Jenkinson. We're from the Oldham Leisure Centre for the Black Flash Promotions. I'm Dan Murray, I'm joined by Tommy Ditz. Tommy, don't know too much about these two, so could do with your kind of expertise in breaking them down.
Well, you can see that Chris Jenkinson is stepping around the block, and you can tell he's fit enough. Now, another thing you want to notice about that is what I said earlier on, I always look at this. When you get the likes of these lads boxing, what you've got to look at is this. I always look at the corners. Now, Jenkinson has got a man there who is a quality journeyman, Curtis Gargano.
Yeah.
Curtis's father also fought some of the best in the world. Culture, I think he went in with the Prince and different people like that. Now, what I'm talking about is this. This boy will know how to defend himself. Now, he's in with the prospect. And the prospect has got a good lead and everything like that. But Jenkinson will make him work for his money. And at the same time, if he sees an opening, he'll let one go.
Yeah.
Because he hasn't, you look at him there, he's very sharp, his record is misleading. What you look at with these journeymen is this, how many fights have they lost on the road where really they didn't lose at all?
Yeah. Chris Jenkinson, I've seen him on the circuit over the years, he's very accomplished and sometimes they choose to go on the road, but I think they play a very important role, don't they, as journeymen, as bringing these prospects
Could
through.
Can I tell you about this? These people give the people, they give the prospects chapters in the book for when they step up.
Yeah.
Now you look, he's no fool at defending himself.
Yeah.
He gets out of trouble easy enough. And also he'll know how to fiddle his way out of trouble.
Yeah.
If you look at it, the amount of fights he's had, there's not many marks on him, is there?
No. No, he's skillful and he's accomplished.
The mark, if you look how many fights, he's been in with the cream, been in with the best.
Yeah.
Don't worry. It's an asset. Most probably, it's just the same as Young Rafferty earlier on. He'll learn more in that 6th round with the Mexican.
Yeah.
Than what he will do with any one round knockouts. Okay, it was 60-54 to score.
Yeah.
That wasn't justice for the fight that the Mexican put up.
Round two of an interesting contest, Tommy. We're just kind of talking about the role of the journeyman. I mean, you've been about a bit. You've obviously very, very experienced. Has the journeyman always played a vital role?
No, because the journeyman, sometimes, if he sees the opening, he will let it go. And you see, it's a world title fight to them.
Yeah.
If they see an opening, especially a top prospect,
Yeah.
And do you see an opening? He gets a bit cocky. They can take him to task, don't you worry?
Yeah.
I mean, there was a middleweight years ago, Ernie Lovelich. I'll tell you one thing. That fella, he's nobody's duck egg. And he went in with the lot.
Is it very important for when a prospect fights a journeyman that he shows him the respect that he's kind of deserves?
You cannot underestimate anybody in this game. You believe me, you cannot underestimate anybody.
Yeah.
And you never judge a person by the record,
yeah,
a journeyman, because there's a lot of fights that are very close.
Yeah. I know you've worked with a lot of fighters. Is that the sort of advice you'd give a fighter, this prospect coming through? Is this the sort of advice you'd give him?
Well, if I was in this last corner, I would tell him to work off his jab, throw the combinations off his jab.
Yeah.
And at the same time, keep a tight guard, because at the same time, these rounds are captured in a boot for when you step up.
Yeah.
You can learn a hell of a lot from a journeyman.
Well, this prospect's called Gibran Bilal, and I'm impressed with him. He's just switched to orthodox now. He kind of switches his stance from southpaw.
Yeah.
And I like him. I like his jab. He works the body well. He looks quite composed. And I like what I see so far.
But this is it. I like what I see with him. And at the same time. But at the same, he's not taking any chances, is he?
No.
And that's the big thing. It's when you take chances,
yeah,
you can come unstuck.
Yeah.
It's a different thing. How many times do you see a person? They show we got caught by a lucky punch. There is no such thing as a lucky punch.
No, absolutely.
You could be nearly out on your feet. You're throwing that punch to hit the man.
Yeah.
There's no such thing as a lucky punch.
Totally agree with that. Every shot you throw is with intent. There's, yeah, no such thing as a lucky shot.
You see, another thing, what I liked about Connor Ward,
yeah,
and Burton was that they were using the lead, their jabs.
Yeah.
Not like a rangefinder. A lot of people use the jab as a rangefinder. The jab can be a lethal weapon.
Round three. This fight, Tommy, it's been fought at quite a steady pace, quite a composed pace. If you're in the corner of Gibran here, the prospect, do you tell him to step on the pace a little bit?
Well, I would, but he's confident in himself. I think personally, what he'll do, I think he's taking a good look around, and I think he's got to step the pace up. Because the simple reason is this, that I think now he's realised that he's being made to work.
Yeah.
He can't afford to miss his punches, because Jenkinson is always in range to fire back.
Yeah.
You want to be very careful getting in close to Jenkinson. Jenkinson knows the score, how to tie a man up.
So just talk about yourself, Tommy. You're quite an accomplished amateur, wasn't you?
I wasn't. Listen, I'll put it this way. The year that I was in, there was no medical cards in 1959. And what I'm telling you is this. There was no DVDs, very few had, people had cameras. You didn't get much write-ups in the paper or anything like that.
Yeah.
But what I'm talking about, some lads did box under more than one name. And you knew if you're going to be any good,
yeah,
someday you'd fight these boys. And what you learned was this. To assess your opponent.
Yeah.
And you'd say, well, I'm going to fight him one day, how do I take his left hand away? And you find out, even though I'm 80 years of age now,
yeah,
if fight, say, a fella that's any good, or, you know, a tasty fight, say, what would fight him, or that lad would fight him, what would they tell him to do?
Yeah.
Now, another thing is this, that you don't see it today, some of the, if a fella with a heavy puncture.
Yeah.
I would punch his bicep. Never mind going for his head. Send them jabs out as quick as I could so yeah. he could lift his arms. Things like that.
Yeah, yeah, crafty, like
yes, yes.
All tricks to learn.
Yes. Now look. You see, in those days, another thing was this.
Fourth and final round. At the end of the last round, Tommy, we were talking a bit about obviously your career, your involvement in boxing, and you touched on an interesting point that back then you didn't have sort of DVDs and stuff, so was there more skill required to sort of work your opponent out? Because look, now you know your opponent before you get in the ring, you know everything they do, you pretty much know how they
well,
train.
You think you do, but look, it's when you get in there that matters. Mm. What it is, no, I wouldn't say there's more skill. What you've got to look at is this. Today, is there many amateur boxers? Because in the GB squad, they're getting paid, aren't they?
Yeah.
Right, not in. In our day, people work. And, I mean, I was when I was a junior, I was a strong lad, a friendly bricklayer.
Yeah.
Right? Now, you, when you got to senior, you say 17, and you fought a fella that was 22, you got in close with him. They break it up now in the amateurs.
Yeah.
They never used to break it up then. Now, they decry the body punching like years ago.
Yeah.
You learn to punch to the body. And not many people have protected you.
Yeah.
Now, what I'm saying to you is this. Somebody come to the Oracle with you, you'll be taught the dirty tricks, how to pull a person onto the punch.
Yeah.
You miss with the left hoop, put his head down and check him with the right. Things like that.
Yeah.
Now, things like that, I'll tell you this way. You wouldn't start it, but I remember getting the instructions of an old fella who was in my corner one night. He said, you're one of Fred Pickling's lads, I said, yeah. He said, you know your way around. This fella's a bit dirty. He said, if he comes to the Oracle, he said, I don't care if you're thrown out, just make sure he's carried out. The instructions I got. now don't you worry. People will, you play the game.
Yeah.
According to.
And one last question, Tommy. Who was tougher, the fighters of your day or the fighters of today?
Well, I'll put you straight. You've got tough lads, and I'm not one of these that say they were better in my day. I think the great fighters of any era would have lived in any era. But I will say this, that I think I was fortunate because what you've got to look at is the generation, the era you're born.
Yeah.
Those lads, the fellas that taught me, the first suit they had was an army battle dress.
Yeah.
When he come back out of services, they hope to make the world a better place. One of my bricklayers took me to court to teach me how to conduct myself in court.
Wow.
Now, that's the sort of article. You believe me.
Well, the end of the contest, I think Jabran Bilal's got that quite comfortable,
oh, yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
I think he composed himself quite well.
The beauty of it.
Right. Good learning fight for him.
Oh, okay. That's how you learn. I mean, what do you learn off of one round knockout?
I couldn't agree more. And I think
what it's all about.
Yeah, I mean, what he learned tonight of Chris Jenkinson is more than what he would win in 10 first round knockouts, wouldn't it?
14 points to 36 points. The winner in the red corner, Jabran Van Bilal.
I'll run the say this.
Appreciation for Chris Twenty Chaos Jenkinson.
Very highly as a referee. I rate him very highly. There's some referees, when I see him in the ring, I think to myself, what sort of...